How are Agilists faring in the pandemic? How are we finding meaning and purpose in these troubled times? How can we connect, inspire, and support each other? We will explore answers to these questions and more. This is Agile Caravanserai. I'm Sanjeev Augustine.
Professor Rashina Hoda is the Associate Dean in the Faculty of Information Technology at Monash University in Melbourne, Australia. Prior to joining Monash, Rashina was a senior lecturer at the University of Auckland in New Zealand. Rashina is an award-winning researcher and an international expert in human-centered software engineering, and she specializes in our own beloved field of agile software development methods. Her research covers agile transformations, self-organizing agile teams, agile project management, large-scale agile, and serious game design for the 21st century. Almost all of Rashina's research is industry-based, and she has this unique way of taking her research and making it globally applicable. In 2019, for example, she introduced the concept of an agile nation, applying agile principles at the wider societal level to solve national and global challenges. I've known Rashina since the early 2000s when we exchanged emails, first on her research in agile project management and later on her thesis, which was on self-managing agile teams. Today in the summer of 2021, Rashina continues to play a hugely valuable role in academia by continuing to provide the theoretical basis of agile methods and for the success that so many of us in the industry take for granted. I'm especially inspired by Rashina's take on agile leadership and her wonderfully global and inclusive worldview. Dr. Rashina Hoda.
It's a pleasure and a privilege to see you, even though you're joining me from across the world. So I'm actually visiting New Jersey over here for a usual change from my usual location, which is Washington, D.C. And you're joining us from?
Melbourne in full lockdown.
Melbourne.
Thank you for having me.
Melbourne, Australia, in full lockdown. And of course, you have a story behind that. You can tell us in a bit. Well, February was the 20th anniversary of the Agile, signing of the Agile Manifesto. And you've been involved with the Agile movement for a long time. You and I have been familiar with the Agile movement. You've been on the forefront of that for a long time. You have this unique perspective where you're both an academic and a practitioner, and you're pretty well known in your space. So I want to just start off with asking you the first question, which is, what are your reflections on the Agile movement over the last 20 years?
Yeah, I think this is one year for reflections in so many ways, personally and professionally. So that's a really good question. With the Agile movement, of course, I think I'll take the research perspective on that because that's the one that I best identify with. So it's been a bit of a roller coaster ride. I don't think any of us imagined how far and wide it would reach. So starting off with my PhD back in 2006, you kind of started to really get to understand Agile. And at that time, it was so new, I was having trouble finding participants for my research in New Zealand. And cut to like the mid 200s and later part of 2010 and getting closer, we've gone all the way from obviously Agile going full scale and all of software engineering, and then outside of software engineering, and now sort of back into software engineering with artificial intelligence coming up and so forth, and we're starting to look at, so it's been really interesting. And reflecting back on it, I think it's the core values that have stuck that's really made it stick for the longest time. And at the same time, we see a lot of going from what I, there's a paper I wrote on the Agile undercover, which is when people used to do Agile, but were afraid to call it Agile because it didn't have the right connotations at that time. And then all the way to the other extreme where, it's kind of a checklist exercise. Oh, we do Agile and therefore work with us. So the whole spectrum that one gets to see in this past 15 years or so is pretty amazing. And as I said, I think it's stuck because of the fact that of those core Agile values, absolutely.
Right, fantastic. So next question, and again, you have a unique perspective on this, and you're talking about the sort of back and forth between lockdown, no lockdown, and all that. But how are you doing in the pandemic? Obviously, it's terrible right now in some countries like India and Brazil, and we're just coming out of a dark place here in the United States. So I think we're sort of blessed that we have vaccines roll out. But how are you doing, and how's your home country of Australia doing in this unique moment?
I think, again, it goes back to that whole reflection point in terms of the realizing that we're so tiny, like the world is so small for a virus to, you know, just spread all over the world and affect everybody, everyone possible. And this doesn't even have to do with your socioeconomic, well, you know, in a way that I think that how you get over it has to do with your socioeconomic context, but getting it isn't, you know, no one's fair.
Yeah,
exactly. It's a huge leveler. And so personally, for me, again, it's been one of those things where I think as somebody who has an agile mindset has really helped, because you kind of look at it in terms of, right, you were expecting a VUCA world in business, but now you've got a VUCA global world all around you, exactly. And not just VUCA, it's like VUCA turned to the max. Yeah, so you don't know what's happening. It's uncertainty all over the place, whereas your personal life, business, international markets, traveling, anything, you know, take anything and there's uncertainty. So I guess people who have not been up with the agile mindset have really struggled. So personally, I think that has helped me a lot to again go back to the values and work from there. But I will say I have struggled as well, because as you asked, you know, about Melbourne in particular. So funny story, a lot of people would be wondering, they're like, oh, Rashina's from New Zealand, they make that connections. I've been you know, of course, in New Zealand for the longest time, and we recently decided to move to Melbourne end of 2019, and then the pandemic hit, and there was this running joke amongst my colleagues and friends, like, oh, great timing to move out of New Zealand, one of the safest Best countries.
Places,
exactly. But be as it may, Melbourne and Australia actually didn't do too bad at all, given the size of the, you know, scale of the country and so forth. But what has been personally challenging for me is the constant switching back and forth. So as I was telling you, you know, until about 10 days ago, we had no masks. We had no restrictions, except for a very, very few cases in public transport and so forth. And we could just go around being almost, if you know, like a pre-COVID normal. And then there was one case, and it kind of, you know, and that person went to the MCG during a match at the Melbourne Cricket Ground, and of course, and a few other places, and now we're back in lockdown. And it's just amazing how quickly it goes from being completely okay to completely not okay. And I think keeping track of your mental health in that period, and just that constant switching, it does take a toll. I have to be honest. I mean, despite your agile mindset, there's you know, limits for everybody. So I'm trying to keep up with the basics around maintaining a routine, getting enough sun, going out and walking into nature and things like that. And just, yeah, and that's how I'm doing.
Wonderful. Thanks for sharing that personal mindset. So my last question is, given that you're in this unique vantage point as a leader in academia and also in practice, and then of course you have an international perspective as well, having been in New Zealand and now in Australia, what's some of the advice that you would give, especially to young agilists as a leader and somebody on the forefront of the agile movement? What's some of the advice and inspiration? I think people are still, as you mentioned, you know, yourself and the rest of us as well, still struggling with this pandemic, but what kind of hope and guidance and advice and inspiration would you have for our next generation of agilists?
Yeah, I think with this one, I would like to go back to the idea of agile nations. So if for people who are not familiar, 2019, in the aftermath of the unfortunate Christchurch incident, I was really just trying to really make sense of what was going on. And as part of that, I was able to connect my professional with my personal, and then, you know, trying to make sense of everything through this concept of Agile Nation, which is how nations and governments and people as a whole respond to challenges. And that was in a very one nation in a very particular context. Now, you know, in 2020, this is every nation and it's the same global challenge. So basically applying Agile for crisis management, whether it's at home or at a government level, right? So that idea of Agile Nation, I think is inspiring. I hope is inspiring because again, it talks about the core Agile values of human, you know, the human interaction being first and foremost. And we know that the technologies that we use and we create, like, you know, Zoom meetings, we're having this wonderful chat over Zoom, really helps, but it does go back to the human connection, to be able to make those connections and be a source of positivity, not like toxic, naive positivity, but acknowledging that people have it differently to you. And people have different ways of reacting. Not everybody reacts with the same way, like, oh, this is going to be fine, we're going to be fine, let's just get through it. Actually, I think it's a longer road than that. So some truths to be acknowledged, and then a lot of strength and a lot of support for each other. So just lifting people up and acknowledging mental health and acknowledging when we need help for each other, you know, when we can support each other. So that's what I would say. Not, you know, I don't have a mantra, but it's definitely something I'm working on in my personal life.
Thank you. Thank you, Rashina. So I'm actually going to put you on the spot and ask you a little follow-up question over here, which I don't know.
Yes.
And that is to drill down a little bit about the Agile Nations theory or concept that you brought up. And you have this wonderful TED talk that's out there on YouTube and all that. But specifically driving that, and watching from the outside, from the other side of the world, I just looked at the leadership exhibited by, I hope I get her name right, Jacinda Ardern, I believe her name is, the Prime Minister of New Zealand. And she's a millennial, she's a woman leader. And she was such an exemplary role model of leadership in this crisis management time. Could you just kind of elaborate on that? Because you're probably you are definitely much more familiar with the details. I would love for our listeners to hear specifically about Ms. Ardern's leadership as in the pandemic, because it's just became a role model for leadership around the world.
Absolutely, it's absolutely exceptional. So with the Agile Nation idea, I think it kind of started from my research, which is the theory of becoming agile. And that's a research which is empirically based. And it talks about the fact that when teams are wanting to become agile, you have to have both the team and the management wanting to do it. And they both have to move towards self-organization and away from micromanagement and away from the old style of doing things. So if one of them is doing it and the other isn't, it's not going to work. Right. So that is at the crux of the theory of becoming agile. And that's what I applied at the national level. And so when you're faced with a crisis situation, you have to have the people as well as the government, right? Both of them trying to work and work in tandem to fix something. And if you look at some of the situations around the world, you have combinations of both the government and the people aren't listening. You have combinations of the government's trying to do something good, the people aren't listening. You have combinations of the, you know, the people trying to do something, the government is off track, not listening to science and so forth. And then you have places like New Zealand and to a high extent Australia and a few other people, places in Europe where the leadership has been exemplar and the people are listening. So it's when the governments, the leadership and the tribe both are working together and in the same direction, that's when you achieve the results. So definitely kudos to Jacinda Ardern for being that very people focused. She's, you know, super agile in terms of being able to respond quickly, right? So when things happen, the lockdown, New Zealand, one of the first countries to lock down as quickly as possible. Yeah. And it was, you know, got a lot of criticism at the point, but it's also been one of the reasons why they've come out through it so quickly. So that's the swiftness of the response. But I think the one thing I really appreciate about Jacinda is her human perspective, that human touch. So I'll share a very quick anecdote. that really touched my heart personally, because, you know, it's not often after the Christchurch attacks, I was, you know, like, what is going on? You know, your head's in a blur, especially being in New Zealand, you never have to think about safety. And suddenly you're like, what is going on? So when you see your prime minister with, like, you know, like a hijab on, and I'm someone else personally wears a hijab, and you feel like, and she doesn't have to put it on every day or whatever, but it's just like a gesture that says, I'm your prime minister too, and I care. So that touched me quite a lot personally. And that that's just one of those examples that goes to show how Jacinda connects on a personal level. It's not just the leadership, which is very, you know, for most leaders, it's like, oh, you can idealize them, but they, you don't relate. With Jacinda and some of the more, you know, the millennials, as you mentioned, they are, you know, definitely exemplary, but they're also relatable. So that, I think, makes it work, makes it tick.
What a powerful insight. I just love to hear that, Sarah. And by the way, that gesture really touched so many of us all around the world. You know, when she showed up in the hijab, and it's like, okay, you know, like you said, I'm one of you, and I'm here for you. I think there was that message there as well.
Yeah.
So it was.
And there was so much, like, she was so genuine about it. You could tell it wasn't a marketing gimmick. It's just like purely her.
And Lord knows we have enough
leaders in the world that actually do that, right?
Yeah.
Like, if you go to a particular country and then wear their costume. But that's not what it was about. So that's why it hit
the right
home.
Gesture at the right time and the right moment. Yeah, very powerful.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, thank you so much, Rashina. If folks want to hear more about you and follow your work, what's a good reference? So where should they go?
Yep. So I think as a startup, the TED Talk that you mentioned on Agile Nations, just Googling that online, but it's also available on my website. So that's just www.rashina.com. And most of actually, just so because I know that most of the practitioners listening, as a researcher, I try to put all of my research online for free, as in my papers should be freely downloadable. So if you're looking for papers on Agile, you know where to go.
That's fantastic. So thank you very much for agreeing to come on the podcast. And I know the timing is difficult to pull off, but we were able to do it. So really appreciate your time.
No, thank you so much. Thanks, Andrew. Thank you.